We'll open the round of question and answer. I'll go to the chat box. If you have any questions till now, please shoot. I'll be happy to answer, and then we'll move to the next section. Any question? I'm waiting for your questions on the chat box before we move to the next section of our discussion. Let's have some question. Any question? Any doubts, any query on whatever we have discussed till now? Great. Okay, if you don't have any question, can I just ask you, how is it going? Is it going fine? Do you need me to improve a little bit? Is it going
So
fine? Are you liking it?
there are two questions. The question number one is from James. In this time, what kind job that we fit in information technology?
Fair.
And the question
So,
number two
Jay,
is, what if the job that are in demand now does not fit your interest and strengths?
right. Great question. Great questions, both. So the first question, in this time, what kind of job that we fit in information technology? So I'm supposing you're asking, if you're doing information technology, what kind of jobs are there? Oh my God. Oh my God. Amazing jobs. So when you go to information technology today, it's not like the ITES, information technology services of 10 years back. Now, technology is everywhere. So there are technology companies which work in the technology domain, whether you want to work in artificial intelligence, cybersecurity, cloud computing, blockchain, IoT, Internet of Things, and so on. When you work on these technologies, you are actually working in the core technology domain, right? Even if you don't want to work in the core technology domain, you want to develop stuff, you don't want to develop stuff, you can go to technology services. When I talk about technology services, there are artificial intelligence services, there are blockchain consultants who don't know how to develop stuff. They don't know coding, but they understand the use of blockchain. They understand the use of IoT. They understand the use of cybersecurity. So, for example, myself, I am not a technology guy, but I have been consulting people on artificial intelligence consulting. The services, the utility. What is the utility of artificial intelligence? I can do it because I don't need to understand how coding is done, how softwares are made, but the utility I know. So, information technology core plus consulting, both combined, amazing options. Amazing options. The only concern is you should go to information technology only when you have a flair of technology, you want to understand technology, you love technology, you have a passion around it. The interest and the strength areas, again, internal analysis. If that is present, if those ticks are around technology, please go ahead. Amazing, amazing field, right? The second question, what if the jobs that are in demand now does not fit your interest and strength areas? Does not happen that way. Does not happen that way. So, Christian, when we do our internal analysis and we find our interest as well as strength areas, right? The combinations are such that the entire in-demand jobs, whatever it is, will fit into some or the other interest or strength areas, right? There is no limit to the jobs which are in demand. There is no limit to the jobs which are in demand, right? A writer, 10 years back, a writer would say that I'm good in writing. Who would give me a job? Possibly a publisher, possibly a comic publisher, a fiction publisher, any books, right? This is what, maybe media. This is what a writer would have done. But today, if somebody is good in writing, you have plethora of content development jobs, which you can do as a freelancer. All the websites need content developers. All the media groups need content developers. All the political parties need content developers. All the corporate houses need content developers. Amazing demand for content developers. So the point is, once you know your interests and strength areas, you would automatically find things to do which will be in demand, right? There are new roles coming up every day because people are liking them. People like to do that, right? Somebody who is good in video making, let's say a few years back, the best they could have done is maybe release a short movie, because releasing a movie would be too big a thing. Today, they go to YouTube, they edit the video, they post it, and they gain likes, and they earn through it. So this is what happens when you realize your actual interests and strength areas. So don't worry about external analysis. Don't you worry, but you worry about internal analysis. You find out the right interests and strength areas, you would be automatically finding great jobs. Right? You would need counselors. If this would have been so easy, people like us won't exist. So that's why internal analysis you can do with the help of a counselor, you can do it better. But external analysis, the mapping, the bridging, that would need some help, right? And we are there to help you. I hope, Christian, I have made some sense in response to your question. Christian, James, can I have a thumbs up if you have understood, or if you have made it a little more clear? Just a thumbs up on the chat box. Christian, James, great, okay. Okay, one more question we have got from Raja is, what a probability to find a job with doctorate degree in environment water treatment? Oh my God, I'm not sure which place are you from, but if I talk about India, amazing opportunities. We have a Ministry of Water Conservation and conserving our rivers, we have a full-fledged ministry. There are contracts being coming up, there are companies coming up just for water treatment. So if you are a person with a doctorate degree in environment water treatment, oh my God, you can, if you want to go into teaching, you want to go into academics, there are so many government universities you can apply for. If you want to work actually, you can create your own startup, you can create your own research, you can sell those research to companies, to governments. You can apply for research jobs in government department, you can apply for research jobs in private companies. Amazing opportunities. Of course, once you hold an education degree and you landing up in a right job is also a task because of the crowd, ever increasing crowd in India, ever increasing job seekers in India. That is a task. But if you follow the right strategy, I think you would definitely land up in a good job. There are portals, make a good LinkedIn profile, try to find out the people in your, the interested industry, the environment conservation, water treatment industry, people working in that industry, find them out on LinkedIn, send connect requests, try to engage in conversations with them. I'm sure there would be great demand for a person like you. So, Raza, if I have made it a little clear, you can please give me a thumbs up. Okay, Raza, I'm just waiting for your response. If I was clear enough, till the time you give me a response, I'll go ahead. So Maynard has asked, from the description of this position, what do you think you will be doing on day-to-day basis? I'm not sure if you're asking about myself. So I, on day-to-day basis, conduct sessions. Most of my day goes into sessions like this. Most of them are one-on-one with my clients. I have institutional clients like schools, colleges, for which I conduct one-to-many sessions like this also. The batch of students sitting online and I'm conducting session. 6 months back, it was offline. Currently, it's online. However it goes, the concept remains the same. A lot of part also goes into startup advising, startup mentoring, and soft skills training, training for interviews, training for group discussions, training for business communication. This is also something I do. So this is how my day goes by. If I have understood your question right, may not. Okay, so Ela Shrestha has asked, I am pursuing MSc Mathematics, but don't want to study further. What are the job opportunities I have? Great. So good question. I'll use your question actually to emphasize on one more important point that all of you should know. Jobs today and in future won't depend on your degree. The kind of jobs you can get won't depend on your degree. It would depend on your skill. Mark my words. The entire country, at least if I talk about India, I'm sure it is true for Asia as well. The entire location, the country and the continent is moving from degree-oriented placements, degree-oriented recruitments to skill-oriented recruitments, skill-oriented jobs. And when I say skill-oriented jobs, when I see your resume, Ela, that you have MSc in mathematics, okay, it's good, it's decent. So I would understand that you have invested time in education, which is good. But what I would be interested in knowing is, are you good with data? Can I hire you as a data analyst? Can I hire you as a statistic analyst? Can I hire you as a data scientist? How do you apply your education to jobs? Only through skills, right? Skills are the only way. So always from now on, when you promote your degree, when you say I've done MSc in mathematics, also try and promote your skills. What are you good at? What can you do? Do you know some softwares? Do you know graphs and charts? Can you be an economic analyst for us? Can you analyze numbers? Can you do data science? Can you act as a data scientist for us? Can you analyze sales for us? This is what any corporate would be more interested in when you're an MSc mathematics, if you want a job in the industry. If you want a job in education, of course, teaching is open. You can go into research. You can be a good mathematics teacher. Great demand for good teachers today in schools, especially private schools and universities. Right? Great, Ela. Thanks for the response. One more question I've got from Abhilash Kashyap is, what are the opportunities in plastic industries in India? I would say pretty stagnant industry, because you're talking about an industry which is considered as a conventional industry. So plastic, iron, steel, coal, petroleum are all conventional industries. The world in general and India in particular is trying to move away from these products. So we are trying to go plastic free. There are campaigns running. So single use plastic would be eliminated if everything goes right by 2030, they are saying. I'm not sure it would happen or not, but single-use plastic, pretty much possible. I don't think there is any other way when we talk about climate change. So plastic industry, opportunities are there. I'm not saying your opportunities are not there, but whether you want to go into manufacturing, whether you want to go into quality control, whether you want to go into marketing, I'm not sure. So conventional industry, yeah, but plastic products would always be there. Single use would suffer, but if there are durable plastic products, if you want to go into that industry, fair enough, there is a lot of space. Fair enough. So I think these were the questions till now. Any other questions? Thank you, Abhilash, for your response. I'll wait for 2 more minutes for your questions, if you have any. Otherwise, we'll move to the last section of the session. which I have to share and discuss with you? Any other question? Okay, Akhilesh has asked, what is the role of parents to choose career option for their children and which is the right time? Great question. Great question. So Akhilesh, parents have an amazing role to play, trust me. Again, I'll relate this to my experience, which has been there with parents. Taking responsibility of your child's career is not something you should do, right? It's not something. Providing support to your child in his journey of career selection is what you should do. Now I'll try and explain it through some examples. So there are parents who have come to me with their child, with their son or daughter for career counseling. And in the 1 hour session that I generally provide, a lot of times it has happened that 40, 45 minutes, the parents have spoke, they have spoken to me and the child just spoke for around 5-10 minutes. So the parents have already decided that I want my child there. I want my child there. When you do this, right? No matter the amount of school fees, no matter the amount of coaching fees, no matter the amount of college fees, you are ready to pay. You might be, willing to pay lakhs or crores of rupees for your child's education. If you are trying to decide your child's future in advance, according to your expectation, you are going in for a gamble. Why I am saying that? Why I am saying gamble? Why I am not saying that you are doing it wrong? Because it's a gamble. It's 50-50. It might happen that your child actually wanted to go there. It might happen. It might happen that your child is suited. Your child personality traits are suited to that career option. It might happen. You're lucky. But trust me, the chances of this happening are less than 10%. There is a 90% chance that you will put your child in a career, in a job, in an industry, in a field which he won't like for his lifetime. And I don't mean that he won't earn. There are two ways a child would react or the results would come if you force your child to a certain career. There are two possibilities. One, he'll fail in the journey. He will fail in the journey. Suppose you have a son and you want him to become a chartered accountant. He follows you, he respects you, you are a dominant parent, and he would follow all of your advice and he would continue towards his journey. Right, and he would work very, very hard, but still he won't pass. Right, he won't pass and he would just fail in the journey. Trust me, you're lucky. Your son is lucky, you're lucky that he has failed in the journey, because now you know that he's not made up for that kind of job, that kind of a field. There are examples of such situations as well. When the child has cleared that exam, pursued that career, went into a good job, doing that job, but in the entire journey, this journey of 10-12 years, he or she has hated his parents. Trust me, hated. Because neither they liked that education, nor they liked that field, nor they are liking the current job that they have. Doesn't matter how much they're earning. This won't matter now. They're not happy. And just go out. Doesn't matter in which country you live in which city you live in. Just go out, talk to people, talk to your known ones. You would find two kinds of people. One, who enjoy their job, irrespective of how much they are earning. They're enjoying. When you talk to them about their job, they will be like, oh, I'll tell you this. This is very interesting. This is what I do. This is what I get to do. And the other category of people who would just seem stressful for the entire day. Does not matter how branded clothes they wear or how big a car they drive, they would be stressful for the entire day. It would feel like their job is kind of a burden for them. Please don't create this life for your child. You want him to be successful, I'm sure, but you also want him to be happy. A happily successful person is way, way more preferable than a very highly successful but unhappy person, right? So trust me, You support your child. And when I say support, it does not mean high coaching fees. It does not mean high school and college fees. It does not mean just spending money. Right? Sorry. What you need to do to support your child is analyze him. Just closely watch him or her. Observe them. You are with them since their childhood. When they are 5, when they are 10, when they are 15, you have seen them developing. When people ask questions, when counselors ask questions, when the time, the moment of truth comes for them to choose their career, you might not know what career options are present, but you would know how your child is, how your he or she behaves. Don't just make it a matter of ego and pride and say he is very good in maths. He does not get good marks in school because the teacher does not evaluates properly. He is a very good guy. He is very intelligent. He is very good in physics, but I don't know what happens to him during examinations. He does not perform, but he is very good. Don't create such illusions. Try to understand your child. If he is good at something, say he is good. Acknowledge that. If he is bad at something, people are bad all times. I have a lot of weaknesses. Even the best of the lot and best of the, I'm sure the CEOs of Google and Microsoft and Paytm and even Bill Gates and Warren Buffett, all these guys have weaknesses. What they have done is they worked on their strengths. They were good at something, they worked on it. So try and identify the strengths of your child and acknowledge it, right? If there is a weakness, please acknowledge that also. That is the biggest support you can give to your child and help him choosing the right career selection. Right career option. I hope I have given little clarity to Akhilesh. Right. So, Svetlana, if I'm pronouncing it correctly, has asked, if you were to start over, would you still choose this job? Oh my God, yes. See, I wouldn't have to start over for this because every day is a start over for me. When I do this job, when I mentor students, when I train students, two of my traits come into picture here. When I analyze, so I didn't analyze this. This happened to me as a learning process because I went into management, I went into corporates. It took some time for me to realize when students who were younger to me, friends of my cousins, asked me for consultation. Where should we go, what kind of college we should target, what kind of courses we should do. And I was just trying to be good to them, mentor them, guide them. And in that process, I had to do my research. What should I advise? Because you cannot advise just like that, right? I didn't want to do that. I did my research to advise them correctly. And this entire process excited me. It was like I was enjoying that. So something that you enjoy, you don't feel tired, even if you have to work your, you know, entire day for it. So that's when I realized I moved to this process of mentorship to students, career guidance, soft skills, communication skills, this and that. The two things I like, I'm always surrounded by students. My entire day goes with talking to students. This is something I like. I like storytelling. I like communication. I like presentation. So this is one interest and strength area that gets satisfied, right? Second thing that gets satisfied means by heart, I like to mentor. I like to share my knowledge. I like to share things in a systematic manner. So a lot of us have knowledge, but few of us have that capability, have that interest of sharing it systematically. That is something I'd like. So I don't have to start over, Svetlana. It's just like every day is a new day for me when I do this job of mentorship. Thank you, Svetlana, thank you, Shyam, thank you, Alexander, thank you, Sovik, thank you, Pradeep, thank you, Anwar Uzam, thank you, Carmina, thank you, Akhilesh. Okay, I have one question from Phil John. He is asking, sir, I'm studying IT and I want to be a game creator. I want to try and make a game solo, but I know it's hard. So I'm thinking of joining a team or a company would be good too. Any advice on what path I should take? Straight advice, I'm not sure whether you're in school or you're in college. If you're in college and if you're allowed, go for internship. Go for an internship in a gaming company. There are a lot of gaming agencies, game developers working, I'm sure, in all the countries now, because gaming is something that has picked up so much in this lockdown. So many new games. Just go ahead and do an internship. Internship are the best way to learn. I give more importance to internships than what you learn in college or school, because internship is where you get to learn while taking risk, right? You get to learn real time. The advantage is you are learning, you are taking risk, but the repercussions, the conclusions or consequence lies with the company, with the organizations. So they take the financial risk, they take the operational risk, but you learn, right? And you learn it real time, practical learning. Go for an internship in a gaming company, in a gaming game development organization. I'm sure you will find a lot of them. Try to engage with the development team there, understand how it works, and then try to do it yourself. That is my advice to Phil John. I hope it's a little clear. Great. Okay, I think most of the things I wanted to cover in the session got covered in the questions. So the role of parents, that is what I wanted to cover. It is not just parents, it's cousins, elder sisters, brothers, all of these guys, all the senior people, you can help your juniors in selecting the right career option. I wanted to cover the importance of skill-based approach, not a degree-based approach, which through one question we discussed. Please lay very high emphasis to this. Guys, the concept of just promoting your degree, whether it's an MBA or an B.Tech or an M.Tech, would go away. People will lay more emphasis to skills now. All the recruiters are doing that. Startups are hiring people who are dropouts of the graduation just because they have good skills, good development skills, good marketing skills, good sales skills. Do that. So few skills as well, which are said as future skills, is of course development, communication, presentation, storytelling, sales and marketing, artificial intelligence, if you have the coding skills, ethical hacking. All these skills are like future skills. And the good thing about these skills is you don't need to get a specific degree to learn these skills. A person in class 7th or 8th is now learning coding. Students of class 6, 7th, 8th are learning about artificial intelligence, cybersecurity. So now the alignment of the degree and the skill is now getting diluted. If you are good at something and you like that as well, you can go for that skill. Whatever age you are, whatever things you're learning. I know people who have learned commerce, but they are now doing coding. I know people who have done engineering, but they are now running an event management company. So it is all getting diluted. Just identify your interest and strength areas and then follow it to create that bridge, right? I think that's it from my side, Shivani. If there are any more questions, I would love to take them individually after this session. You have my mail ID. You can share that with the participants. And I hope. Okay. I have one more question from Arsalan. Sir, what if someone selects his or her career and after that he realizes that it is not suitable to external environment? Does not matter. Presumably, if you are in such a position, wherever you are, whatever you're doing, just start over. And when I say start over, I don't mean start over with a job. I mean start over with the right career selection process. Start over with the internal analysis. Wherever you are today, after this session, do an internal analysis. Again, list down your interest, list down your strength. Now try to map it with the right jobs that are available in the market, right? You might have to attain some skill. If a class 8 student today can attain a skill on coding, why not you? If a class 10 student can learn storytelling, why not you? You might get good in sales, you might get good in marketing, you might get good with numbers, you might get good with coding. All depends on your internal analysis. So try and do that, attain that skill, start over. I'm sure it would take like maybe 1 month or two, but you would be again back to the market. Thank you, Crystal. Thank you, Arsalan. I think that's about it, Shivani. If it was all good enough, we can call it a day today, and I can take these questions if the students have any after this session. You have my mail ID. You can share it with the participants. Make sense?
Sure, sir.
Okay.
Thank you for the wonderful session.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me here for the session, and all the best to you, to EduRoots, and to all the participants. Thank you. Bye bye.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.